Hello, this is Niswander, and you're watching The Now Man Show. Joining us today is the award-winning documentary filmmaker, musician, and journalist, Morgan Neville. He's an Academy Award-winning filmmaker who has been making films for over 20 years. He's covered art and historical events, but he's best known for his documentaries about music, including films about the Rolling Stones, Keith Richards, Stax Records, and the Memphis Soul, Muddy Waters, Johnny Cash, Hank Williams, Iggy Pop, and he even won an Academy Award in 2014 for his documentary called 20 Feet From Stardom, which is about backup singers. The Music of Strangers opened last summer after playing in festivals such as Tribeca and Berlinale, and features cellist Yo-Yo Ma and the Silk Road Ensemble. Morgan Neville, thank you for being on The Now Man Show.
Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
2014, you actually won the Academy Award for Best Documentary of a film called 20 Feet From Stardom, about extremely talented singers that were like Judith Hill, Claudia Lennear. Lennear, I'm sorry.
Sure.
Tate Vega, of course, Mary Clayton, and Darlene Love.
Sure.
What was it like working with well, before we talk about the film, let's watch a clip.
Sure.
Singing background remains a, I suppose, a somewhat unheralded position,
There's a power to these women that stand on stage with these guys.
It's a bit of a walk. That walk to the front is complicated.
Can you turn off the radio?
How could you logically not have a diva have her music on? I don't get that.
The rock and roll people like Bruce and Elton John and Stevie wanted to know who that girl singer was. My life has been all about trying to make a success of the gift that I had.
She was like the really hot one of the kids. She was very hot, beautiful girl.
I don't set out to be the sex symbol.
But you post in Playboy.
My greatest pleasure is to stand back and let them do what they can do.
When you're a backup singer, it is a springboard, but it can easily become quicksand if that's not what you want to do.
There's no guarantees in entertainment.
I've got dreams.
Rough dreams.
I felt like if I just gave my heart to what I was doing, I would automatically be a star.
It got so bad, I started cleaning houses. I just looked up and said, okay, you're supposed to be singing. There's a whole world out there who wants to hear you sing.
They're in the game and they stayed in the game, and they're legends.
It is my honor to induct into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and about time to Miss Darlene Love.
What was the real story behind what inspired the creation of that movie? Can you tell us?
Sure. The real story. The idea belonged to Gil Friesen.
The producer.
The producer. And Gil had been the president of A&M Records for a number of years. And the story he told me the day I met him was that he had recently gone to a Leonard Cohen concert and had smoked a joint and had spent the entire concert fixated on the three amazing backup singers.
Yeah.
And if you've ever seen Leonard Cohen, you know he has amazing backup singers, and he features them in incredible ways and just uses them. And Gil said he spent the whole concert thinking, what's their story? And he said when he woke up the next day, the thought was still in his head. You know, what are their lives like? And he said, so this is my idea. Let's make a documentary about backup singers. And I said, that's really interesting, because as much music as I know and as many music documentaries as I'd made, I didn't really know much about backup singers. And I said, well, what do you think the film is? And he said, well, that's your job.
Yeah.
And it was just kind of jumping off the cliff and hoping that we found something. And there were no books to read. There was no way to research it other than to just talk to backup singers. And we ended up doing maybe 80 interviews with backup singers.
Wow.
and figured out how it worked. I mean, it's a very tiny community of people.
Yes, yes.
And they're the most amazing artists. I mean, to be a backup singer, you have to be the best of the best, because you're working without a safety net, you're walking into a different session, and you don't know if you're singing, you know, rock and roll or opera, practically.
Yeah, and these are people that grew up, you know, as I did, like in church. So you get a lot of your education, your music education in church. So yeah. I understand the harmonies, the melody, and all of that stuff. And these women, I mean, the amount of work that they did amongst all of them, like, for instance, Claudia Lennear, you know, actually dated David Bowie for a while, and she was the inspiration for Lady Grinning Soul. Then you have Vega, who, you know, has worked with Elton John, and Leon Russell even did that backups on that Union album that they did together. And there's Mary Clayton, of course, who did that infamous Gimme Shelter, you know, and because of that, she did the Feeling All Right with Joe Cocker. She did Sweet Home Alabama with Leonard Skinner. I mean, it just goes on and on. And then, of course, you know, Darlene Love, who was, I've interviewed Denny Tedesco, the Wrecking Crew film, so she was part of that story, too, with the Crystals, and she was even in the Blossoms, which I talked to Don Randy about, the keyboard player, and of course, you know, for years, she was on the Phil Spector Christmas album, she did the David Letterman show every Christmas, I mean, just so many interesting stories and interesting people, and that's just the tip of the iceberg.
Yeah, but at the same time, invisible.
I mean, yes, I know,
this is the thing that, and we were talking about earlier, about hearing something different in something you know, and when I first started thinking about this film, I mean, I think I literally sat down that night and said, okay, well, let me just think of songs with great backup vocals.
Yeah, yeah.
And I had a hard time coming up with five or 10.
Yeah, yeah.
Because your brain does not think of them that way.
Yeah,
you know,
exactly.
And nobody ever thinks about it that way. And so I went through my record collection. I had the radio on. I mean, for the couple of years I was making the film, I was keeping a running list. I'd hear a song on the radio and go, oh my God, of course, that song has great backup vocals. But it's hard to think of those things unprompted. And but what it does is retrain your ear. I mean, now I always hear backup vocals, you know. I pick it out all the time. And then understanding that it's the same people who do this and this and this and this, and they do it because they're incredible artists. And really then kind of realizing what their journey was, many of them, like you said, from the church, but on their own kind of journeys through the Wild West of the music business and everything else, and how they all come out on the other side. So it became a spiritual journey, even though I didn't know what it was going to be going into it.
How did you get down? I mean, the stars of the stars of this movie basically are the women that I mentioned. I also didn't mention Judith Hill, who actually was on with Prince when he had to do the emergency landing a week before he passed, and he produced her album. What was it that made you decide to make these basically? I mean, you obviously have to pick stars for the film because there's so many people you could have put
in
this film.
Well, like I said, we interviewed 80
backup
singers.
How did you narrow it down to that?
I mean, it was
difficult
because I think I was looking for a group of women that represented different generations of backup singers who had great success, who had sung on well-known songs, but who had made different decisions or had different things happen to them throughout their careers. That was incredibly hard to find that group of characters, so it all kind of fit together like a puzzle. And, you know, I think there were certain people, somebody like Darlene Love. I mean, she was one of the first people I interviewed. And I remember turning to Gil the moment I finished the interview and said, well, we could always make a Darlene Love documentary. She was so great. Her story was so big. I just said, okay, well, you know, we have something. We have a film, and let's keep building. But then people like, you know, Mary Clayton, who's a force of nature, and, you know, playing her the Give Me Shelter isolated backup audio track of her singing. That was another one of those moments where I just said, oh, my God, that was incredible. Oh, no, now I have to clear a Rolling Stone song.
But it was amazing.
Yeah.
And we'll continue this conversation in part two of the interview with Morgan Neville. And you're watching The Now Man Show. This is Niswander. We're getting ready to change the world. So stay tuned.
I'd like to read a book, but a song that has so hooked.
Hello, this is Niswander of the Now Man Show, and I'm here with Academy Award winning director, producer, and writer Morgan Neville. Welcome back.
Thank you.
We're continuing our conversation from last time we ended, talking about actually the Academy Award winning film, which is 20 Feet From Stardom. There's just so many stories that we could go into about this. What else can you say about that film?
Let me maybe just tell you about the experience of taking the film out in the world. It's one thing
to
make the film.
Yeah, that sounds great.
It was such a crazy ride, because when you make a film, you kind of hope that your parents are going to like it.
Yeah, right?
Or something,
exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
Your expectations are very low.
Yeah.
And certainly when I showed up to interview all these women, they didn't think the film was going to go where it went. You know, they thought, oh, yeah, you're another guy with a camera who's... Mm-hmm. You know, it'll end up on YouTube somewhere.
We've seen it 100 times. And yeah.
But there was something about the film. I mean, we put it together and we were really happy with it. But I didn't show it to any of the women in the film. And opening night at the Sundance Film Festival, we had the opening night film.
Wow.
And the women were there, and there was a packed house. We'd never shown it to more than five or 10 people at a time.
Wow.
And there was just an incredible kind of spiritual experience happening in the screen that I've never had before.
Amazing.
It was one of those kind of once in a lifetime experiences. And then the women of the film came out, and it was just charged, you know, and they started singing, and it just became this roller coaster that we were on for more than a year, from Sundance to the Academy Awards.
Wow.
But the best part is that you don't expect your film to really be that transformative.
Yes.
But it changed everybody's life. And the thing I'm so grateful for is how it changed the lives of the women who were in the film. And people like Claudia is singing again. She wasn't
Fantastic.
Singing at the time. Lisa Fisher has her own band, and she's touring the world.
Great.
Playing in jazz festivals and jazz clubs, doing exactly what she should be doing.
Exactly.
And Darlene's been doing better than ever. And Mary Clayton, was in a car accident, and
yes.
She's getting better. I've told she's gathering her plans for her kind of reemergence.
That's great, because she even was able to do the Coldplay album.
Yeah, she
Coldplay
did a song album. On the Coldplay
yeah.
album. And Judith Hill, as you mentioned before, did an album with that Prince produced. And I actually had the opportunity, Judith called me to go out and film something with
yeah.
her at Paisley Park. This
wow.
is about a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
And there's no way you can turn down an invitation like that.
That's right.
Paisley
That's right.
Park is like...
I've almost gone. I almost went one time and I didn't go. But,
yeah, you feel like you're getting the ticket to Willy Wonka's factory or something.
Right.
So,
so never, yes. That's a good way to put it. I like
yes,
that.
I'll be there.
yeah.
And we had the full Prince experience. And
yeah.
and Judith, I think the album was great. And I was really happy for her. And then I just, you know, we're still in touch. She's actually local here in Pasadena. So
oh, wow.
Judith Hill, so
wow.
you might want
That's
to
great.
Talk to her sometime.
Yeah, that would be fantastic.
You know, because she has a great story, too, and comes from a great musical family.
That's, yeah, I'm already interested.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm a huge Prince fan, too, and actually had a show one night in a club that he played, and I had to stop mine, and so I knew Power Generation could play. It was amazing, amazing. Because, you know, when you play a small club, you don't play, I don't have to play the hits here, I can play whatever I want,
exactly.
and that's exactly what we got. great memory for me. Now, you also have a lot of we're briefly going to go into the non-musical part, because there's some interesting stuff here too, so let's get right into this. You were also made movies at the beginning, you know, with Sidney Poitier, Gloria Swanson, the Houston family was, you know, there. And there was The Joy of Lex, that TV
yeah.
movie that Henry Rollins is in?
What, yes.
Can you just briefly tell us what that was?
It was a crazy idea, and it turned out great. It's a documentary about lexicography.
What is that?
Words.
Words, really?
Yes.
So, I learned a new word.
Yes. So it's about, as we said, it was a movie about words and the people that use them.
Wow, so interesting.
It's just, where do words come from? How do we invent them? How is language used? You know, it was kind of a crazy idea.
Was that the poet in you that made you want to make that film?
Yeah, but I'm also like a crossword nut. And
oh, really?
Wow. You know, kind of, I love words. So it just was one of those crazy ideas that we did and was great. You know, it's, you know, when I think about what unifies my films, it's that they're all about culture,
yes,
in a way.
Yeah.
Language, I've made art films,
yeah,
and even a film like Best of Enemies with Gore, Vidal, and William,
yes,
F. Buckley is really,
yes,
a film about media or a film about the culture of politics.
We definitely want to get into that, yeah, towards the end here. And you did the Cool School.
Yeah, the Cool School.
And that was about the Ferris Gallery, right?
Exactly.
What was that for those that may not know here?
For those
Los
that
Angeles?
Don't know, and actually Pasadena has a good role in this film,
really? Yeah,
too.
That's right.
That the Ferris Gallery was the first real modern art gallery in Los Angeles. And that first generation of great LA artists came out of that gallery. That's Ed Ruscha, Robert Irwin, Billy L. Bengston, Ken Price, Larry Bell, Ed Keenholtz. And it was also the gallery that first showed Warhol.
Oh, yeah.
The Soup Can Show premiered here in LA, not in New York.
And Duchamp, too, right?
Marcel, yeah, Marcel Duchamp. Duchamp. The co-founder of the Ferris Gallery, a legendary curator named Walter Hopps,
yeah,
left the Ferris Gallery and took over the Pasadena Museum of Art.
Which became
the Norton Simon.
Yeah, yeah.
So the first pop art show in the world happened here in Pasadena.
Really?
Yes. It was called New Paintings of Common Objects. And it was the first museum show that Andy Warhol or Ed Ruscha or Roy Lichtenstein was ever in.
Wow.
And it happened right here.
Wow. See, a lot of people don't,
yeah,
probably know that history. You know, and then let's watch a clip.
In the 1920s, Italian immigrant Simon Rodia started to build a series of spires in his Watts backyard. He said he wanted to build something beautiful as a tribute to his adopted city, so he made the towers from what he found around him, garbage. The job took him 33 years, and after he completed it, he handed the deed to a neighbor and vanished, never to return. In the wake of World War II, a new generation of renegade artists decided to stay in LA and make a go of it. Choosing to ignore the art history that New York dictated, they looked around to the ugly boulevards, automobile graveyards, the flashy billboards, to find inspiration and called it art. The place where they found each other was called Ferris.
There is this tendency out here just to not care about art history, but it's because we're a young city. We're not an old city. We're not surrounded by art. We don't have to deal with our past because there is no past.
Even though we didn't have enough evidence, we were completely confident that we were on the right track and everybody else was full of shit, you know?
The work that was going on here in the early 60s was as important as any work being made anywhere in the world.
Yeah. We got something that's different out here and we can compete with New York. And that's cultural ambition. They had a pool of interesting artists and something was percolating. And then you got the spark, the Ferris Gallery.
There's a film that actually was in the shortlist at the Academy Awards this year, Best of Enemies,
mm-hmm,
which basically, you worked with Muddy Waters producer on that as well.
Yeah, Robert Gordon.
Robert
and I
Gordon
did it together.
And it's about the William F. Buckley and Gore Vidal debates. There were like 10 of them, right? Tell us about that. And well, actually, let's watch a clip and then we'll talk about it.
This is Miami Day One.
Republicans decided to hold their convention south of the Mason-Dixon line. And I blew that one.
Pieces of the ceiling start flying, and then the whole thing started giving away.
To help us extract meaning from these conventions, two of America's most eloquent commentators, William Buckley and Gore Vidal.
Bill Buckley was the first modern conservative to see that ideological debates were cultural debates.
Mr. Buckley, do you think miniskirts are in good taste?
On you, I think they are.
The people at ABC asked him, well, is there anybody you wouldn't go on with? And he said, the only one I can think of is Gore Vidal.
Gore Vidal is one of America's most successful and distinguished writers.
We are all prostitutes in one sense or another, ethically, if not sexually.
For Buckley, Vidal was the devil.
I am a happy warrior. I'm in battle. I'm enjoying it.
He represented everything that was going to moral hell.
These were two visions of America clashing.
Each thought that the other was quite dangerous.
All this security makes me very nervous, because it's necessary, apparently.
If Buckley were not taken out, his ideas would take down the nation.
The country is being split at the seams.
It's almost as if they were matter and antimatter.
Say that again. Freedom breeds inequality. Now say it a third time.
No, yeah, twice is enough.
He's always to the right and almost always in the wrong.
I confess that anything complicated confuses Mr. Vidal.
A grotesque example.
He's nothing feigned. They really do despise one another.
Now listen, you
right
Korea,
of the
stop calling me a crypto-Nazi.
Let's stop calling names.
I'll slap you in your goddamn face, and you'll stay plastered. This is William F. Buckley, Jr. in New York.
Perfect.
So, Morgan, what was this film about in detail?
This film was about William F. Buckley and Gore Vidal, famous right-wing intellectual and famous left-wing intellectual, yeah, who had a series of nationally televised debates in 1968. On top of that, they hated each other's guts.
yeah.
And they thought that these debates were going to help determine the future of the democracy.
Yeah.
So the stakes were high.
Yeah.
But what it really is a story about how media has changed. This moment became, in a way, the template for pundit TV we have today.
That's right.
And something we're living in right now in the middle of an election season. So these were all the things I was thinking about. Personally, I've been fascinated with both characters. In fact, I used to work for Gore Vidal.
Oh, you did?
Yes, as a fact checker.
As a fact
yes,
checker?
Yes, so.
Wow, that must have been really interesting.
Yeah, it was horrible.
It was horrible? Oh, wow.
No, I mean, I have tremendous respect for Gore, and he was a great writer. My job was to tell him he'd gotten very small facts slightly wrong. And if you know anything about Gore Vidal,
yes,
you can imagine that he didn't enjoy mm-hmm. being told that. It was an educational experience.
Yeah, to say the least.
But making the film, was just really exciting for me because it got to talk about all these kinds of issues I'm interested in, which is how we talk with each other and where we can find common ground. And whether that common ground comes from the difference from the front of the stage to the back of the stage, or through characters like Johnny Cash and Hank Williams, who are championed by people to the left and the right. And,
exactly.
I'm always looking for those areas of commonality.
That's fantastic. There's a New York Times article that came out about the film written by A.O. Scott. Mm-hmm. And I like this quote here. It says, "There's no doubt that the debates were a harbinger of cable news shouting matches to come as television journalism is transformed itself from democracy's buttoned-up super-eco into its snarling id." That's a pretty, I mean, to me, that's a compliment that, you know, that you portrayed that exactly accurately.
Well, I mean, it's a compliment, but I'm unhappy that it's true.
I hear you.
That in a way, media should be mediating.
That's right.
What it should be doing.
That's right.
And in fact, it's become the opposite. It's become something that, again, divides us rather than unites us.
Exactly.
And these are things that I'm always focused on because I come out of media and journalism myself, and I'm always looking and having real dialogue and looking for common
ground.
Yeah.
Exactly, and allowing all voices to be heard. You know, I think that's really important, not just focusing on one, but the full spectrum, which we're not always seeing these days.
And
right?
That's it's complicated because, you know, the democratization of media has also led, unfortunately, to the democratization of truth.
That's right.
So now, if we don't have to listen to a centralized media, which, and there are many good things about that, we don't necessarily have to agree upon facts anymore.
That's
right. And that is a very dangerous thing.
That is very dangerous. You're absolutely correct. I couldn't have said that one better. You know, and I noticed in that review, right, also, you know, it was rated R, and I've never seen an R rating like this before. Riots, war, sexual revolution, and a threatened punch in the face.
That should have been the tagline. Yeah,
that should have been your tagline. You know, maybe when you re-release it, it'll be that
I like
way.
That.
I understand you're working on a documentary about the infamous Baptist minister, children's show host, Mr. Rogers.
Yes, that's out.
Now, and you are working also on some other projects, too. You want to tell us what's going on there?
Yeah, I have some scripted projects I'm working on that are really exciting. And I'm just finishing a show about designers.
Oh, cool.
And again, it's another corner of culture that, to me, fits right into my sweet spot of kind of looking at design, which is something which is a balance of, you know, art and culture and commerce. You know, like
and
how do
all
we,
the different
you know,
ways you can do design?
Yeah. So everything from graphic design to industrial design.
Interesting.
But really, how do designers think, and how do we take apart the world and put it back together as designers? And we all design because designing is basically just decision making. So it's been really fascinating, and that's coming out next year.
That's fantastic. Well, can't wait to hear more about all these projects. And thank you so much for being on the show. Where can people learn more about you?
Follow us on Twitter. My company's Tremolo.
Tremolo, and you're based in Los Angeles?
We're based in LA, and I'm based here in Pasadena. But Tremolo Docs, I think, on Twitter, and Facebook is Tremolo Productions, and we're easy to find.
Excellent.
So, yeah, thank you.
Morgan, thank you very much for being on the Now Man Show.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. This is Niswander. Until next time, stay in the moment.
Very often when people perceive that to be a scene, you know, sometimes there isn't. In this case, there really was.
Glenn Frey and Henley was there.
John Lennon.
That was the only time I met Janis Joplin.
It was the hang.
It was a hang.
The guys that turned out to be the Eagles used to be sitting right over there all the time.
You'd go in the bar and you'd say, everybody in show business was at that bar.
The Mecca was the troubadour. Even though there was a club called the Mecca.
By 1970, the heart of 60s rock was going down. Beatles were breaking up. The Stones were inactive. So rock and roll needed time to take its breath.
I'd like to continue with a song that I wrote myself not too long ago. It's called I've Seen Fire and I've Seen Rain, and it goes like this.
I've seen fire and I've seen rain.
And when it was taking its breath, that's when this singer-songwriter movement was at its most powerful.
It was just all this generational turbulence, cultural turbulence. There was a hunger for the intimacy, the personal thing that we did.
Authenticity of somebody telling their own story was what people were interested in.
I feel the earth move under my feet.
These songs are really the fabric of a generation and of a society.
I've been celebrating the 20th anniversary of the release of Adventures in Wonderland, also the 10th anniversary of The Universe According to Now Man.